Thank you. This is Susan, Representative Susan Elmy of Lebanon from the House Ways and Means Committee. I find that due to the state of emergency declared by the governor as the result of the COVID-19 pandemic and in accordance with the governor's emergency order number 12, pursuant to Executive Order 2020-04, this public meeting is authorized to meet electronically. Please note that there is no physical location to observe and listen contemporaneously to this meeting, which was authorized pursuant to the governor's emergency order. However, in accordance with the emergency order, I am confirming that we are A, providing public access to the meeting by telephone with additional access possibilities by video or other electronic means. We are utilizing Zoom for this electronic meeting. All members of the committee and select legislative staff have the ability to communicate contemporaneously during this meeting through this platform, and the public has access to contemporaneously listen and, if necessary, participate in this meeting by clicking on the following website address, https://www.zoom.us/j/92613036532, or dialing one of the following phone numbers, 1-929-205-6099 or 1-301-715-8592. B, providing public notice of the necessary information for accessing the meeting. We previously gave notice to the public of the necessary information for accessing the meeting, including how to access the meeting through using Zoom or telephonically. This information is printed in the House calendar. C, by providing a mechanism for the public to alert the public body during the meeting if there are problems with access. If anyone has a problem, please call 603-271-3600 or email H as in House, C as in Committee, S as in Services at leg.state.nh.us. D, adjourning the meeting if the public is unable to access the meeting. In the event the public is unable to access the meeting will be adjourned and rescheduled. I want to introduce the staff that are in the meeting assisting us. Jen Four, House Community Researcher, is the meeting host. Additional House Committee Services staff providing support are Brad Greenland, Pam Smarling, and Christina Dyer. This is an executive session on HB 1563 FN and HB 1627 FN. The Ways and Means Committee held a public hearing on HB 1563 FN, March 4, and a public hearing on HB 1627 FN, March 5. Both are second committee bills and had to be withdrawn from the earlier executive session for further work. Copies of the bills and other relevant materials have been posted on the main page of the General Court website under the heading Remote Meetings. Please note that all votes that are taken during this meeting shall be done by roll call vote. Let's start the meeting by taking a roll call attendance. When each member states their presence, please also state whether there is anyone in the room with you during this meeting, which is required under the right to know law. Please, Representative Malloy, call a roll.
Representative Ames.
Do we not have represent? Yes, we have him. You're muted.
He knows.
Now? Okay.
Now you.
Yeah, I'm present. I'm at my home in Jaffrey, and I'm alone.
Representative Carrick.
I'm here in Warner at my home, and me and my dog.
Representative Southworth.
I'm present at my home in Dover, and I am alone.
Clerk is present at home in Greenland and is alone. Representative Schamburg.
I'm in Wilmot, and my wife is in her office.
It's an executive.
Representative Tucker.
I'm in Randolph and I'm alone.
Representative Bunker.
I am at home in Exeter. My wife is in and out of the room. I'm listening on headphones.
Representative Gamarlo.
I am home in Swansea and I'm by myself.
Representative Griffith.
I am here. I'm actually in Falmouth, Massachusetts at work, and coworkers are in and out.
Oh, wow.
Representative Lockman. Representative Stringham.
I'm here in Lincoln, New Hampshire, by myself.
Representative Major. Representative Major.
You have to unmute.
Representative Major, you may have to respond to a prompt on your screen.
Okay. I'm here in Plasto and by myself.
Representative Griffin.
I'm Mary Griffin at home in Windham and alone.
Representative Ullery.
Home in Hudson, by myself.
Representative Abrami.
Present at home in Stratham and by myself.
Representative Lang.
Representative Lang, you're muted.
Request is to unmute, but I haven't gotten a response.
He may not have showed up again yet.
Representative Doucette.
I'm present by myself now in Manchester at my office.
Representative Edwards.
I'm Representative Edwards. I'm at home in Auburn, New Hampshire. I have two dogs and my wife running in and out of the room.
Representative Burstein.
Nottingham, New Hampshire. I'm told it's beautiful here today. I'm by myself.
Representative Almy.
I'm home alone in Lebanon, which one of the prettier parks is behind me.
Representative Malloy, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it appears that Representative Lang is live again. If you would like to call his name again.
Representative Lang.
Representative Lang, I'm in Saratoga Springs, New York, and I am alone.
That's the roll call.
Thank you. We are up to 19 this time. So we're going to take these bills in numerical order. On House Bill 1563 FN, relative to the use of funds in the Drug Forfeiture Fund. I'd like to ask for a motion from Representative Southworth.
Representative Almy, I apologize for interrupting, but I just noticed that Representative Ullery had raised his hand before you started your last statement.
Oh.
You know, if you wanted to take him or...
yes, is this about procedure or something?
Don't know.
Representative Ullery?
I just wanted to know who gets the prize for the longest distance call.
We can't have people moving off to Alaska in order to compete for that, I think. Okay, so I want to recognize Representative Southworth for a motion on 1563 FN relative to the use of funds in the Drug Forfeiture Fund.
Thank you. I'd like to make the motion of interim study for HB 1563 and speak to my motion.
Thank you. Can I have a second? Representative Stringham, did you just raise your hand?
Yeah, I'll second that.
Thank you.
Okay, for the motion, we had a work session and we had many questions, and really the questions led to other questions. So we need more time to resolve some of the complications of this bill. Also, we want to request an audit of the funds.
Thank you. If I could clarify, the audit would be a performance audit. We have to do a formal request from the committee chair to the committee, which for performance audits, which doesn't have a meeting time scheduled yet, but which should be meeting sometime later this summer. And I hope that we can actually get them to do a performance audit of the transparency with which the funds are used. It is actually written into the law about the drug forfeiture fund. Thank you. Any further discussion of this bill? Representative Tucker had her hand up.
Yes, I wanted to thank the proponents of this bill for bringing it, the whole issue forward, because it did turn out, as we looked into it, that it was a much more complicated topic than we had realized, or that I had realized. And so I think this certainly performed a great service to us to open up and examine a small section of how the state operates. And I'm grateful for that.
Thank you. Any further, Representative Burstein?
Thank you. I'd like to thank Representative Southworth for his motion and Representative Springham for his second. I know we have a lot of common ground in this bill, and I know I readily acknowledge all it has written, and I look forward to working with the other side to fix the problem and eventually get this passed. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion? I don't see any more hands up. Well, then the clerk will call the roll on interim study for House Bill 1563-FN.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
Yes.
Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo.
Yes.
Representative Griffith.
Yes.
Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang.
Yes.
Representative Doucette.
Yes.
Representative Edwards.
Yes.
Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almy.
Yes.
Vote is 19 yes, 0 no's.
The vote being 19 to 0 for House Bill 1563-FN to go into interim study. The motion passes. Is there any objection to consent? Not hearing any, I will offer it for the consent. Thank you. The other bill that we have to deal with today is House Bill 1627 FN, creating an animal records database. And I want to move to pass on the bill. Can I have a second?
Second.
That was Representative Griffin. And now I would like to move amendment. I printed out this amendment. Last night, there it is. The amendment dated May 22, because there have been a sequence of them, 1254H to HB 1627 FN. Is there a second? Representative Abrami is waving his hand. I think you need to say something. Can you unmute if you mean to second it? Thank you.
Second.
Okay. So if I can speak to my motion, the creation of this database is the year's highest priority for the Department of Agriculture. Its limited staffing means it has not been able to get copies of vaccination records, which are held only at town halls and needed quickly when an animal bites a person. And they would not be able to deal with receiving all the health certificates, which health certificates are now required of them for various key functions by law. The department is run primarily on user fees, making it hard to budget for capital expenses like creating a new database. The bill came to Ways and Means in our capacity as the overseer of dedicated funds. It borrows from two funds, one closely related and one not, to establish a computerized database for all animal health records, and which may in the future be expanded to add other functions. These two funds, one for animal feeds and scales, mostly animal feeds, and the other for integrated pest management, accumulated surpluses over several years because the department did not fully staff the functions. Now fully staffed, they do not need those surpluses to operate for the foreseeable future. The database shall be developed borrowing funds from these surpluses and be maintained over time from a new fee of $2 or less on certificates of health and rabies vaccinations. The department believes that the veterinarian's current costs of time, forms, and postage exceed this fee. The committee amendment directs the repayment of the donor funds first to the integrated pest management, which is about plants, not animals, and then to the animal feed fund. It specifies the timing and direction of all the transfers. At the request of the first committee and the department, it allows the customer's certificate copies also to be digital so that they would not have to receive a paper copy if they do not want one. Finally, it sets a 5-year limit after the database goes live on transfers to avoid any further borrowing between funds. Is there, Representative Schamburg has his hand up.
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Madam Chair, I have a different opinion on House Bill 1627 FN, the amendment. Mm-hmm. You've done a quality job work in drafting the amendment for the sponsors and the Commissioner of Department of Agriculture. if this bill were just about raising money through a fee for the compiling and administrating of certificates of vaccination for city, town, and clerks to access to a known database that is already operational within the Department of Agriculture, I would find no objection to supporting this bill. But I feel that the cart is before the horse. This is a capital improvement program request that I believe should have been first submitted through the state's capital funding program procedure. The proposal for this House Ways and Means Committee to develop short or long-term capital expenditures for any department of this state, I do not believe is this committee's responsibility. This database that the Department of Agriculture and sponsors want for this record retention should be shouldered by the state's capital improvement fund process, not the owners who must get a health certificate, rabies vaccination, license information for pet vendors, and et cetera. My two basic objections are, this bill has put the onus upon the House Ways and Means Committee to resolve an infrastructure deficiency that should have been addressed by the New Hampshire Commissioner of the Department of Agriculture through a state capital improvement fund request. State infrastructure requests are more than just roads, vehicles, and buildings. This committee has not been informed or shown that a request to move the Department of Agriculture into the 21st century was initiated, and what was the response from the powers to be if there was such a request. My second objection is that I find great displeasure with the language that the commissioner of the Department of Agriculture is not being required to reimburse the transferred monies from the Agricultural Product and Scale Testing Fund and the Integrated Pest Management Fund at the end of 5 years. The use of the word may, page 2, line 6 of the amendment, puts no responsibility upon the commissioner to make whole again the Agricultural Product and Scale Testing Fund or the Integrated Pest Management Fund by the end of year 5. And that brings me to this one subpoint. The commissioner during the public hearing also implied other confusing, cloudy, potential financial disclosures within the administrating of the department. Why hasn't the commissioner over the last 2 year period asked for an audit to clear up any confusing financial fund estimates? With an unclear financial picture within the Department of Agriculture and not requiring repayment to the Agricultural Product and Scale Testing Fund and the Integrated Pest Management Fund, a Pandora's box will have been created. I find that I cannot support this bill. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. That is quite a long statement, and part of it is for the entire bill, not the amendment, but I guess we can discuss it now. Unfortunately, there seems to be nobody in the attendees that is from the department or the Agriculture Committee right now. If I'm wrong, I'd like one of them to raise their hands.
I just offer that if one of them is calling by phone, the raise hand function is star 9.
One of them is trying to call by phone?
If that's the case, I just saw a number of phone numbers.
Well, while we're waiting to see if we can get, I thought that they were going to be here. They may have not realized that it moved to 1 o'clock.
Jess Andrews has his hand up.
Yes, Jess Andrews has his hand up, and I was going to go to him next while we were waiting.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And I'm always impressed with the thought that Representative Schamburg puts into his positions. He says a lot in his first point relative to this being a capital investment and that probably should have gone through the DOIT and all. And gosh, I wish we would have had an opportunity to talk about that when we were sort of talking about this amendment face to face, because it's an interesting topic. I'm probably still going to vote yes for this amendment, but I wanted to voice another concern. Since we were face to face, I've had a number of people start to share with me their very strong concerns about vaccine registries and mandatory vaccines and all of that. And I think if I had had an opportunity, knowing what I know now, I would have asked for the additional line in the amendment that this IT system shall not be used to store any human personal health information. That moment has passed. I'm going to vote yes on the amendment, yes on the bill. But I did want to just kind of get it at least on the record with you all that I'm concerned about these two things. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to try to reach the commissioner who apparently is not on here. Which in the process of trying to get all of this straight, I managed. I think actually I had his cell phone number from when he was a member of this committee a long time ago. Hi, Commissioner Jasper. I am okay, but we are in executive session on 1627. And we've had quite a lot of questions put at us by Representative Schamburg, and apparently nobody representing agriculture or the agriculture committee is on. Yes. Yeah. Yes, I understand that problem quite well. Jen?
Yes.
Can you read me the number that Commissioner Jasper should call in order to join this meeting?
There's a series of numbers. I could email the directions to him.
Are you in a, Commissioner Jasper? He's in his office, so that would work to email them to him. I'm afraid that Representative Schamburg read quite a long statement. So I'm not sure if we're going to have to require him to repeat it once you're on. Why don't you get on and I'll synthesize them and then he can say if there was something else. Okay, thanks. Thank you. Okay, we're going to have to, I would like to just say this agency is almost entirely user fees. And I believe that the problem would be that the user fees would have to be raised in order to pay for this database. And since the database won't be up and running yet, the money would have to at least provisionally be brought in from the general fund to pay for the capital budget expense, reducing the amount of money that's available for the general expenses of the state. And I believe that it's been primarily user fees because it provides principally for the agricultural sector, which is lamentably a lot smaller than it used to be in the state of New Hampshire. But Representative Arami?
And I'm a unmuted. Just a question for my friend, Representative Schamburg, please. I just want to, you point out three issues that you have with the bill. We've had a couple of work sessions on this, maybe not on the bill. We had a work session on it, not necessarily on this amendment, but did you bring these points up before, or is this more reflection over time now that you've concluded these things? Because, you know, we had a work session just the other week, and how many of these did you bring up as issues?
Representative Schamburg?
Well, yes, I'm waiting to be unmuted here. Okay.
You're unmuted.
Representative Abrami, on March 5th, I appreciate your questions. On March 5th, the commissioner had made a statement about financial confusion, trying to figure out how much money there was. And I had asked the question about the financial figures in the department. So it was brought up. And this other position that I've taken about the being a capital improvement, I didn't ask the commissioner that, but the more I looked at the bill, it is what it's becoming as a capital improvement program. I was just reading my opinion here. I don't know if it'll change anybody's view, but I thought I would state what my objections to this bill are. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. That's fine. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Yes, I think the commissioner, and we still don't seem to have him in. I cannot remember, can anyone remember when the commissioner became commissioner? Chris, do you remember that? You're in here, Chris Shea. He must have. Chris?
I'm sorry, Rips of Almy, I didn't hear the question.
Do you remember when the commissioner became commissioner? How long it's been?
He stepped down from speaker to do it. I don't remember. He's been there a couple of years now, but I don't remember how long.
Mm-hmm. The state, certainly before he arrived, the state of the finances of the Agriculture Department were rather complicated, shall we say. And essentially what they've been doing for many years is to try to exist on a minimal, very minimal amount of money. And that means sharing staff time over programs. It means doing without a lot of things the rest of the departments have. Representative Edwards, I see your hand. Oh, a lot of hands are up now. So Representative Edwards. You're muted.
Okay. I just wanted to answer your question. I believe it was fairly early in 2019 because we were halfway through the previous term.
Uh-huh.
Or so.
Right.
And that's the answer to your question, I believe. And then I just wanted to thank Representative Schamburg again. He said it was just his opinions. But the opinion on the capital investment, I think, is just really a great point. And maybe we discussed it, but it's certainly an important thing for us to be comfortable with. So thank you.
Representative Tucker is the only one left with a hand up now.
I believe that the commissioner became commissioner in January 2019.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, this is the commissioner again. Hello, it's... It just came in? Okay, good. Thanks. Okay. He just got the email. Representative Tucker.
I believe the commissioner became commissioner in January of 2019. That's about a year and a half ago.
So it's been about a year and 3 months or less since he was testifying to us on the bill between those two times, yeah. Okay, so he should be here any minute.
So Representative Volmey, I looked it up. Commissioner Jasper became the commissioner November 22nd, 2017. November 18, 2022.
You said he became commissioner in November of 17?
Yep. And his term expires in November of 2022.
Okay.
5-year term.
Mm-hmm. So that's even further back, considerably further back. Representative Schamburg wants to say something again.
Yes, Madam Chair.
Yes.
I didn't mean to cause all this confusion. I'm just stating my opinion, and I thought we would be moving on then to vote on your motion to approve this amendment. Yeah.
Well, you've raised several questions that I think people want the answers to.
The commissioner is on the line and he's available.
Oh, he is. Good. Attendees has gone up, but could you just let him ready? Oh, there he is. Good. Commissioner Jasper, the main points that Representative Schamburg raised were that this should have gone to a request to the Capital Budget Committee on first and should include on going, this is from Representative Edwards, that it should have gone through on the Department of Information Technology and Representative Schamburg also wants the full repayment to be made by the end of the 5 years and says that that you had said yourself that the finances of the department are still in disarray. And he felt that this ought to be postponed, I think, in order to get the finances in array and have a chance to talk to the Capital Budget Committee.
Thank you for the questions. We didn't believe that it should go as a capital request because we were able to self-fund it, and the likelihood of this competing with all the other capital needs of the state, I didn't feel that we would have any chance of success given the directives that have come down. So we were trying to do this through creative financing. I don't believe that I said that the state of the department's finances were in disarray. I think what I said was that there seemed to be a lack of balance in one of the accounts, but that there's plenty of money there and we were working on that. What I told you was that more money was being drawn against that than seemed to be coming in. But with the staffing that we have been allowed to have, that actually is getting better every month. But nonetheless, in that account and the other account, there's plenty of money, and the other account is actually building up more quickly than it should be. In terms of paying it back in 5 years, the fee would have to be much higher to do that. But as I said in the last meeting that you had where I spoke, there is a real nexus to the to the pet food part of this. And so I'm very comfortable with this fee, this money coming out of that that account, even if it isn't paid back. And that's why I think we talked about the fact that if, in fact, we had to use any money from the pesticides account, that would be paid back first. But I don't need to take money out of the pesticide fund. Not sure if that covered everything. So a lot of questions there, but...
Yeah, have you gone talked with DOIT about how you do this?
Yeah, we have talked to DOIT mainly in terms of the security issues on there and the fact that they will be one of the vendors, if you will, who will be bidding on this in all likelihood. Although I have to tell you, we're doing another program that was a should have been online last year through DOIT. Mm-hmm. And for those of you who've been around a while, if you remember when we were changing over the program for the house, the system crashed a couple times, one right in the middle of a vote, and that it was described as putting a square peg in a round hole. We are in the same problem with the weights and measures program right now that DOIT is actually doing for us. It's just not an off-the-shelf program. You really, for some of these things, need to go to a company that is more specialized. But DOIT is aware of this. We've spoken with them about it. They'll be taking a look at it once, and they'll no doubt will be a critical part of putting together the request for proposal at that time.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Do we have anyone who wants to ask further questions, or I don't see any hands being raised in the committee. Representative Tucker? You have to unmute, Representative Tucker.
Sorry. Since we have the commissioner on hand, it would be nice to have him have a chance to just give two or three sentences of why this is an important project.
Thank you.
I've gotten a little away from that.
Thank you. And I had if I may, Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Yeah, I actually had a long conversation with a state senator this weekend about that. And the reality is the legislature has asked us to, or instructed us to run this pet vending program. And we cannot do it to the extent that we've been asked to without a whole lot more personnel or without this program. And obviously we don't even have the space to house the personnel or the documents that we're being asked to collect. So for the legislature to say that we need to register everyone who is breeding 25 dogs, cats, ferrets, et cetera, not to mention all the fish and everything else in here, we have to have this program. And as I have been saying right from the beginning of this, it's not fair to the department to ask us to do a job and then not give us the resources to do it. In this particular case, I didn't ask the legislature to give us the funding to do what you asked us to do. I came up with a creative way to fund it within house, recognizing the limitations of the state finances, which of course are much worse now than when this started. So we've tried to be responsive in all ways to what the legislature has asked us to do. But we simply cannot do the job without this program.
Thank you. I'd like to add that the pet vendor program was inserted by the Senate into HB 4.
You are correct.
So, Any further questions or comments, Representative Abrami?
Yeah, let's not lose sight of that. This is a second committee bill. The policy we're talking about was approved by, I guess, the Agriculture Commission. And what we're weighing in on is we're the guardians of the dedicated funds, as you mentioned earlier, Representative Ami. And all we're doing here is giving an approval to dip into those two funds for purpose. So that's what our vote is. And up to this point, I think we've all agreed that that was okay to do. I know this is the final vote, but we haven't heard any real negative comments about doing that to this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments from the committee? Then the clerk will call the roll on amendment 1254H on ought to pass on the amendment.
Representative Ames. Representative Ames,
you are there.
My vote is yes. Sorry for the muting problem.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Is he still on? Yes, he's on.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
No.
Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo.
Yes.
Representative Griffith.
Representative Griffith, are you there? He seems to have stepped away.
I've requested unmute a few times without response.
Mm-hmm. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery. Representative Ullery. Okay.
I was waiting for the unmute to show up. Yes.
Thank you. Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang.
Representative Lang votes yes.
Representative Doucette.
Yes.
Representative Edwards.
You have to say something.
I know, but the problem is the central muting and unmuting is problematic.
Yes.
Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almy.
Yes.
Vote is 17 yes, 1 no, and 1 not voting.
Correct. Thank you. The vote being 17 to 1, Amendment 1254 passes. I would like to move House Bill 1627 as amended by on Amendment 1254H. Is there a second?
A second, Representative Abrami.
Thank you. Seconded on House Bill 1627 FN, amended by Amendment 1254H, is moved by Representative Almy, seconded by Representative Abrami. And is there any further discussion? I don't see any hands raised. So the clerk will call the roll for ought to pass on House Bill 1627, amended by 1254H.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg. Representative Schamburg.
No, the unmuting is not quick enough.
I'll slow down. Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo.
Yes.
Representative Griffith.
Still away.
Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang.
Yes.
Representative Destet.
Yes.
Representative Edwards.
Yes.
Representative Burst.
No.
Representative Almay.
Yes.
Vote on 1627 ought to pass as amended with amendment number 1254-H is 16 yes, 2 no, and 1 not voting.
Thank you. On the motion of ought to pass with amendment 1254H for 1627 FN passes on with a vote of 16-2. Is there an objection to the consent calendar? I don't see any hands up. Then it will go on consent. Thank you. That finishes our executive session, and thank you, Commissioner, for joining us. The committee is going to stay.
Stand up, perhaps before you move out of exec, I'm not sure. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yes. What did you want to do before then?
No, I just had my hand up, Representative.
You just put it up.
Yeah, you didn't ask if there was going to be a minority report.
Oh, well, there can't be if we're on the consent calendar. And I asked that. Does anybody want to?
I'm wasn't certain about that one. There still can't be a minority report and be on consent?
You can't have a minority report on consent, no.
Okay.
If anybody who wants to see a minority report, Tom Schamburg has his hand up now. On Representative Hello. Schamburg.
Yes, I'm waiting for it to be unmuted. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I appreciate my good friend from Stratum. Do you want to volunteer for the minority report? I don't want to write one, okay?
No, I was just trying to be fair, my friend. You know that.
Okay. Representative Burstein, would you like to do a minority report?
No, thank you.
Are you saying yes?
I said no, thank you.
No, thank you. Okay. So do I hear any objection to the consent calendar? We will go with the consent calendar then. Thank you. So we are going to reform ourselves. I've got to put away the exec council papers, exec committee session papers, and collect my revenue papers. Again, it will take me 1 minute. Is anybody else need a longer break? Then this executive session is ended, and we will reconvene in 1 minute as the revenue estimating session.
Susan.
Yes?
Can Chris put up the Excel spreadsheet so we can check the numbers?
Okay. Why don't you put up page one, and then we can look at page two after that. Is Chris there? Yes. Chris, did you hear that? Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you.
I did hear it. My dogs were barking, so I stayed muted for a second longer.
Jen, could you tell us, do we have to call a roll again when we go back into exec?
When you're restarting the revenue, you mean?
Yes.
It's my understanding, since you did it earlier, that you should be all set.
Okay, because I think we have Representative Griffith with us now, who wasn't here then. Well, we've got his picture. I don't know if he's behind it.
I'll unmute him if you want to try to. Or I'll try to unmute him. I'm not getting a response.
Yeah. So I guess we don't have to do that. Representative Major, you can just tell us when you want to move to the next screen.
Representative Gomarlo has her hand up.
Representative Gomarlo? I can't see them now. I'm going to have to. There we go.
I just wanted to tell you I need to leave at about 20 to quarter of three for an appointment.
Okay.
So when I disappear, that's why.
We may be able to make that if we go along at the pace we were doing before we had to break for the executive session.
Okay, Liquor?
Liquor.
We're taking the agency numbers for both high and low for 2020.
Yes, and which is 130.1 and 131.1, correct?
And right, and the same numbers for high and low for 2021.
And all we did on the first year is round it down to 130. And the second year we rounded down to 131, but we went up to 134 because the liquor commissioner was telling us that total spirits I think that's what it's called, is has switched to what its second stage usually is in coming into new territory in Massachusetts and raise their prices there so that they are no longer competitive with us in a number of items for the price. And we thought that this would probably bring us back some people from Massachusetts. But we went up 3%.
Now, that's curious, why didn't he go up?
Why didn't he go up? I think that he presented this argument about coming, about possibly being able to be more competitive with them again in the Massachusetts market. But we didn't ask him about whether he would go up, be willing to go up because of that on his estimate. There's also the issue that I believe Representative Major and I talked about at one point, that his numbers as they are for 21, I believe include 2.7 million.
I didn't think so, but
yeah. You have no. He took out the 2.7 million in the second year for the sale of the property that they could not sell this year, but that they have out to bid right now to do in July or August. And he believes that the bid, there've been a number of legitimate bidders who looked like they were going to be pretty good and that they'd be able to get their price. If they did that, then the 131.1 would go up to 133.8 in the second year. And that money represents how much they have to pay on an annual bond, that they would be paying off enough of the bond that they could pay 2.7 million less. They had originally included in their plan that they were going to be able to make that sale this year, and it hasn't happened.
If that's is dedicated to the bond payment, then it wouldn't be made available to the general fund, right?
So, Representative Almy, if I could respond to that.
Yes.
So what they're suggesting to you is, because you're in the liquor fund,
mm-hmm.
having an expense of 2.7 million, you'd have that revenue coming in from the sale that would offset what they had earlier when they did the budget, had projected was going to be $2.7 million of debt service payments. So in a sense, you gain that 2.7 in your revenue.
Yes. Because the revenue that we see is net of all of their expenses.
Correct. And the sale of this land was something that was negotiated after or separate from the budget. This is kind of outside that process of the revenue estimates that were done originally.
If that's correct, then I'm okay with that range.
Representative Abrami has his hand up.
Yeah, if I recall our discussions in our caucus, we decided, we were going back and forth on this one, what to do with that 2.7 million. I guess my recollection, maybe I'm wrong, is that we said that let's just treat it as found money if it happens, took the more conservative approach, because there's still an outside shot that the deal may not happen. So that Hampton sale happening. So that's why we took the more conservative view.
That's correct.
But we are looking at a range here. So I'd like, and there's also the total spirits question, but
that would fit within the range.
Well, it would fit within the range that we'd proposed, but you didn't propose a range.
Well, that's what I meant.
Yeah.
I mean, if we want to do the range that way, Norm, I have no problem with accepting that range. I don't know about you.
Yeah. Let's go with it.
Okay. So is there anybody else that wants to add something? Then we'll vote for liquor on revenues in FY20, $130 million. And in FY, or do you want to do 0.1 or just leave it at 130? On
130.
Yeah. In FY20, 130 million, and in FY21, 131 to 134 million.
Yes.
So the clerk will call the roll for the liquor estimate at FY20, 130 million, and FY21, a low of 131 and a high of 134.
Representative Ames.
Yes, yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
Yes.
Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo.
Yes.
Representative Griffith. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette.
Yes.
Representative Edwards.
Yes.
Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Alme.
Yes.
17. Hi. Yes. 0, no, and 2 not voting.
Thank you. We have Representative Ullery's hand up for some reason. Representative Ullery, did you want to?
Yeah, I just got an email from one of my contacts in law enforcement regarding tomorrow.
Oh, sorry. So.
Just stay away from Manchester and Nashua tomorrow.
Oh, well, since we're in the middle of a vote on liquor, the vote being 17-0, the motion passes for liquor revenues in FY20 at 130 million and in FY21 as a low of 131 and a high of 134. We've got that put in. And the next one is lottery. We've managed to group the syntaxes together. And we do have somewhat bigger difference on this one. We all take the lottery commissioners on estimates of 95 for 20 and 100 for 21 as the base. We on our side have gone up 5 million to 100 as the high for FY20 and up 10 to 110 for FY21. And it had to do with Charlie McIntyre not including in his estimates from what he was saying, at any rate, the opening sports opportunities that are showing up, or the scratch ticket boom, which so far is a boomlet. We don't know how long it will go. But the sports betting had been pretty much closed down by COVID, and they seem to be getting back up on their feet again. So anyone want to say something about the difference between the highs on those two?
Representative Almy, Representative Abrami has his hand up.
Representative Abrami. Every time you put up the spreadsheet, I lose the participants.
Yeah, let's go with 21 first. So your high assumes that we would get to close to the original plan.
Yes.
Which I don't know how that's going to happen. I mean, Charlie's not going to be open for a while, but that's a very small number, I know. Restaurants are opening slow. We know they're going to continue to open, and that's the Keno money. I don't know. I don't think we're going to get up to 110. We could probably add something in, but. But not all the way to 110, I don't think. So I think we compromise on that. And on the other side, I think we're relatively close. We could split the difference, I guess. But that's my thoughts. I just don't know how to get to 110. And I know we're having the boom, like you said, in scratch tickets, but that could just be a phenomenon of the COVID situation that we have no explanation for. But the tickets that aren't selling that are the Mega Millions and Powerball, which are pretty significant revenue for us. So, I don't mind compromising on this one, but if you want to go on 110.
Mm-hmm. On Representative Major, would you like to propose something different or comment?
Yeah, my comment is similar to what Pat has said, to compromise somewhat on 21, but not to 110. This is again a function of where we're going to the pandemic, and then I'd rather stay closer to the 100. I would bring, if I put a range on it, I would really push it by going to 105, 100 to 105. That would be it.
Mm-hmm.
As far as year 20,
mm-hmm.
split the difference.
Something like 95 to 97.
Yes.
He did in his report to us say that it's 95 and 100, but then he says that major sports are beginning earlier than we thought will be. That being said, a few other factors must be recognized, meaning that they aren't in his estimate, that major sports will begin prior to September 1, and that the Mega Millions rolling jackpot is going to yield significant revenues if it continues to roll. I don't follow it, so I don't know. And this boomlet in scratch tickets, which are usually very predictable. But of course, that would be showing up this year, but in next month's revenues. I don't know, Chris, do you know what the end of May is for? For lottery?
Their number wouldn't have changed from what you saw earlier in the dailies.
Oh, right.
$2 million for offer plan.
That's true. I didn't. Not sure where I've got that, but anyway.
Senator Ames has his hand up.
Senator Ames. How did I hear that? That's Senator Ames.
Yeah, so I just wanted to weigh in support of the compromise that's been suggested. So it would be, I believe, 95 to 97 as a range in 2020 and 100 to 105 in 21 seems reasonable to me.
Okay, Representative Tucker. Representative Tucker is muted.
Yes, that seems very reasonable to me. I think that's a good compromise on both.
Is there any further discussion? Then the clerk will call the roll on lottery revenues FY20, low of 95, high of 97. FY21, low of 100, high of 105.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
Yes, slow on mute.
Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
I didn't hear a response.
Said yes.
Yes.
Oh,
I didn't hear it either.
Yes.
Representative Griffith. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette.
Yes.
Representative Edwards.
Yes.
Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almy.
Yes.
Vote is 17 yes, 0 no's, and 2 not voting. Yeah.
Thank you. The vote being 17 to 0, the motion for on lottery revenues in FY20 of low 95, high 97, and in 21, low of 100, high of 105 passes and have been put into the lottery column. So now we've finished with with the regular spreadsheet for the general fund and the education trust fund. The total numbers that we've got seem to be 2,427,000,003 to 2,501,000,003 in 20. And in 21, 2,261 low to 2,427.1 high. And it's really nice to be able for all of us to see those before it gets turned into a green sheet for the hall. So I hope we can continue to do this once we get back to meeting in person again. Then we have the highway fund. Oh, should we take a, we can take a vote on the whole thing in the end, right? So
you can, you got Reps of Major's hand is up, and Reps of
Major's
hands are up.
I lose the hands every time you put up the split screen and forget to put them back. Representative Major?
Chris, you'll send, you'll email these sheets to us.
Yeah, absolutely. So when you're done your work today, I will make these available to everybody on the committee. I'll send them out to you. And I can also send the Excel sheet as well. We'll put the PDF on, make it available online on the General Court website.
Good.
Good.
Thank you.
And Representative Tucker had a question or yes. comment?
I had a comment. I'm just thrilled that the Ways and Means remained able to negotiate and be bipartisan. I attribute that a lot to our chairman and Representative Major getting together and others, but really it's a great thing when you see so many other units of government unable to even be civil to each other, much less work together. And the organization that went into this meeting between the staff and the leadership really is outstanding. And I just wanted to comment on that before we bog down into fish and game and transportation.
I don't think we'll bog down, but I want to wait to the end to thank people. just so we don't lose any more people before we go on. The highway worksheet, if we can get to that. We have, I wanted to take just three votes and ignore miscellaneous. It can be added in if we want to motor vehicle fees.
That sounds good with me, Susan.
Yes. So the first one is the road toll, which is the largest single source, that was put in by the agency as 114.7 for 2020, and the Republicans mirrored it. The Democrats went from a range of 115, which is 114.7 rounded, to 117, very small range for 2020. And in FY21, the agency put 115.6, and the Republicans mirrored it. And the Democrats raised it to 118 low and 125 high. Now, I believe that basically we did that because every day that we go out on the roads now, we see more and more cars getting back on the roads, both cars on the highways and cars in our local areas. And it does seem that the opening for, in terms at least of driving to the supermarket and driving out to a piece of country where you can calm down a little bit and be isolated, but in nature, is expanding a fair amount. The parks are having trouble with too many people trying to come in some places at least. And we also think that it will increase on a lot faster on the basis of that, but not to the original level that the highway fund had been expected to reach of 132, but about halfway up to that before during the year. Quicker than it shows in the especially in the second half of the year that they are of the term, the fiscal year, the first part of 2021, quicker than it shows in their monthly revenue numbers that we were all sent. But we were sent as a PDF. And I took those numbers here. I took those numbers manually into a Excel spreadsheet. I hope in the future we can get these things not in a PDF, but we've never had these before, so we have no historical review of how much they differ from month to month and what they've done with that. But we have, through April at least, what this is in a much more detail than we can get when we're looking at a chart in the back of the revenue focus. And the July to February road toll average for 2020, that is July 19 to February 20, was $10.87 million per month. And that would yield for a normal year 130.37, which is a little bit higher than the official plan was for this year. But this is not a normal year. And in March, the numbers started to go down. And in April, they were down a fair amount, but we're all seeing a lot more people in May coming back on the roads. Not anywhere near normal yet, but enough so that we felt we could go up to at least 117 on that by the end of this year. And road toll 21 what their sheet shows us is that they do not expect to see normality in the road toll until June of next year. And before that, it will be varying up and down as the months do. But the average from June to May, July 20 to May 21 for road toll, they have as an average of $1.3 million lower than the average that we had before COVID this year. And I only did these numbers after we had our caucus, but we'd done a on view of it just generally by eye during the caucus, and had decided to put the numbers up a little for the first year and then up more in the second year than the 10 million more almost than the second year estimate. Because unless we have a major resurgence of the virus almost equal to what we had this time, the traffic should continue.
Representative Volmey, you've got three questions. Representative Southworth.
Yes, Representative Southworth first. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. And I remember the discussion in caucus. As I sit here today, I find I'm leaning a lot more towards the agency estimate. I think the tolls will probably drop at least 10%, because just in talking with people, I think there'll be less trips by New Hampshire residents. I think people just are feeling they need to stay put really for a while. I also think there are going to be certainly less tourists. So when I look at that 132 and plan, I think it may drop at least 10%, at least for 1 year. It's kind of where I'm leaning at this moment.
Okay.
So maybe slightly higher than the agency estimate, but not by much. I just think I'm just hearing from people that they're really changing some of their plans.
Mm-hmm. These are for longer trips.
Yes, or even do short trips not as often. People are talking about not going to the beach as much, or you know, different things like that. It's just what I'm hearing.
Okay, and it may be different in different parts of the state, because definitely yeah. In our part of the state, we've got more traffic.
There is more, but I still think it might be 10% less mm-hmm. than the original.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's, 10% for June, if we're talking about 2020.
No, I was talking about 2021.
Oh, okay. Okay, so 10% less would be 13 from 132.
Around 118.
Around 118. And then next is Representative Abrami.
The last 3 weekends, and all I can tell you is that all the parking lots were all in overflow. And half the license plates were from Massachusetts and Maine, mostly Massachusetts. So things are picking up. I don't have a problem going up a little bit on our estimate. But let Norm weigh in on this one as well. He's unmuted as well.
Yes, he has his hand up next. Yeah. Okay, Representative Major.
Well, thank you. You gotta remember that the agency came up with their $114 million. for FY20 based upon about 3.5 months of reduced gas taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're looking at 2021. You're going to have reduced gas taxes. Maybe not at the rate that we had in April or May, but it's going to be over a period of a whole year. And my feeling is that we need to take down the 132 by at least 11%, such as what the agency did. And I think they did their job well.
11% would be 14.5, I guess.
Yeah.
But that the agency took it down further than that.
Yeah, 15.6, not much difference.
No, 14.5. And that's 170, 117.7, I think, six, whatever.
Yeah, you're getting down to the range that the agency had projected. And and I think they're really being conservative. And this will blow up if we don't come back at a steady stream. If we have disruptions, a second wave or a third wave, it'll get worse. Because now we're dealing with a whole year's worth of reduced travel rather than just 3.5 months. And then you have to figure it's always like about a month behind. So it's really like 2.5 months or so. So I think you got to be careful when you step up.
Okay. What about people in other parts of the state?
Representative Burstein has his hand up, Representative Almy.
Oh, yes. Representative Burstein.
Thank you. Actually, I just want to relay a message from Representative Edwards. He said his home network crashed. It's in process of rebooting, and he hopes to rejoin us soon.
I didn't hear that.
Representative Edwards' home network crashed and he's trying to get back.
Oh, okay.
So I'm wondering if people are having different experiences in different parts of the state, because we're getting to the point where we're at about, I'd say 70% normal at this point in our traffic. And it came back really quickly in last month, May.
And you've got to realize that 70% versus that's for 1 month looking at it, but you're going to have a reduction over almost the whole year.
Mm-hmm. But over time, you think that it will stay, once it starts to come back, it will plateau again?
I'm hopeful that it doesn't exceed 11% total for the whole year. Mm-hmm. We know that coming into around now was about 35% at the toll gates, or 40% at the toll gates.
The toll gates were last week, they were down to a 37% loss, I think it was.
Yeah.
It was falling down, the loss was falling down considerably from 1 week to the next for a couple of weeks.
And if it takes a
year. And I don't know what this weekend was.
If it takes a year to fall only 5%. You take the average over the year, and it's going to be over 11%.
but it doesn't, it didn't take a year to fall 5%. Anyway.
No, okay. It fell dramatically, like a step function.
Yeah, right.
But it's not.
I mean, the loss has been falling considerably from one week to the next each week in tolls.
It's not going to come back as a step function.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, Representative Tucker.
Yes, I think the whole tourism part of the economy is going to be affected all summer and fall.
That's true. Things
are being canceled in a big way. Our Fish and Game Department has asked the White Mountain National Forest not to open up Tuckerman's Ravine, for example, for an extra 2 weeks because they're afraid of injuries that might drain their staff. And all kinds of things are still being canceled. And a little tiny thing, but they're talking about canceling almost all their events and hikes, organized hikes for the summer. Mm-hmm. And people aren't planning to come who usually come here for 2 weeks to a month. So I think we're going to see really substantial change in each segment of the state.
Representative Malmey.
Representative Burstein.
No, it's Representative Malmey.
No, oh. Representative Burstein had his hand up.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I tend to agree with all these comments. I would consider New Hampshire fortunate if we only eroded 10% next year. I think Representative Southworth gave the number 10%, Representative Major 11%. If at the end of fiscal 2021, if that's where we are, I think we would be happy. Not only do we have the tourism concerns, but there's been such dislocation to the economy, it makes sense that we're going to see less traffic. I mean, look at our unemployment rate right now. To me, at a minimum, 10%, and I could be convinced to go north from there, maybe up to 15%. But I think that's the range I'm working in, a floor of 10 or 11% and north of that. That's my only comment. Thank you.
Okay, so next year we're talking, if we're talking about 10%, we're talking at one 13.2 off of 132.3. That would be around 119.
We can make that the midpoint, the 119, make that the midpoint of range. And I think that'd solve the problem.
Would that be acceptable to others?
And have 119 as the number for FY 21.
Well, right. If it.
So we have a range around 119 as the midpoint. So let's say 115 to 1.1 or something like that.
Well, it could 116 to 122 would be 3 in either direction of that.
Yeah, right. I'm sorry. Yep.
Is that acceptable to people? Because it starts above, well, it doesn't start above the rounded number for the highway people, the safety people.
So what you're saying is 21 would be 116 to 123?
To 122.
Say it again.
Oh, 21 would be 116 low to 122 high.
My other thought is, as I look at that now, maybe bring it down a million on each, maybe bring it.
Yeah, I was thinking that might be more acceptable to people. Yeah.
115 to 121, something like that.
Yeah, I'd go for that.
And Southworth has his hand up.
Representative Southworth?
Yes, I feel better with the 115 to 121.
Mm-hmm. And this year, could we say 114 to 116, or?
Why not?
Or should it stay? What do people want?
Why not?
114 is lower than theirs and ours.
Yeah, it is.
So 115.
Why not call it 115?
Yeah, okay. Just one number.
Yes.
Yes.
Any further thoughts? Then the clerk will call a roll for road tolls for the highway fund on in FY20, 115 million. In FY21, 115 low to 21 high, 121 high.
This is for the road toll of the highway fund. Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
Yes.
Representative Tucker.
Yes.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo. Oh, I think she had to leave.
That's right.
Representative Griffith. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette. Representative Doucette.
Representative Doucette, it looks like he's here and he's unmuted, so he may have stepped away.
Okay. Representative Edwards.
Yes.
Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almey.
Yes.
Vote is 15 yes, 0 no's, and 4 not voting.
Thank you. The vote being 15 to 0. The motion for road toll and the highway fund FY20, 115 million, and FY21, a range from 115 to 121 million passes. We now have the all the other fees ranges in the highway fund grouped as motor vehicle fees. They mostly are motor vehicle fees. There's no money that came in from sales or planned for next year of sales of vehicles. So the department had estimated that we would end 20 with motor vehicle fees up to 124.7. And we the Democrats had looked at that, and I hope someone else remembers our argument for this. I can't find any papers that deal with this at the moment. It's probably written on one of our documents. But we thought that it was likely to come in lower than this. Probably we had a low of 115 million and a high of 125 million. In 21, the department had a number of 119.3 million, and the Democrats looked at it and thought that it might go as low as 118 and up to 123. So focusing around about a million more than they were saying. We do know that the motor vehicle fees go down next year about 5 million, I think, because we're in the fifth year next year of a transformation that's been going on for two decades now, I think, in which we went from a four-year license to a five-year license, and the fifth year usually drops off. So I need to get back my participant list. We don't have a hand up yet. I'm going to try to find my, this ought to have it. It was from our caucus report, except that there isn't anything written after it. So is there anyone else that can help me out on this as to why we thought they were too high the first year and not high enough the second year? I can't remember at this point. We always do the highway funds at the very end when we're getting tired. Have we got anybody in attendees?
You have Representative Brahmi and Representative Ames and Major all with their hands up now.
Oh, they just put them up as I moved over to attendees. Representative Brahmi.
Can we take Representative Ames first, because he was on the committee? I think he probably has the recollection of your logic, the logic.
Good. Representative Ames, do you?
I'm sorry, Patrick. I do not have a recollection.
Okay. No, I don't either. So,
so I guess I'd say under the circumstances and the need to close this out, mm-hmm. that we should rally around the agency number.
Okay.
I concur. If you want to put a range around the agency number, that's fine too.
Yeah.
Move away or something.
Well, we, the trouble is we only get this from the revenue focus. We don't get breakdown at any time until
we can. We just have to invite them in.
Well, when we asked for it this last time, we got a monthly spreadsheet, which is for the road toll, because that's what we'd asked for. Oh, no, it's for all of it. So, but I only analyzed the road toll because it was a lot, took a lot of time to enter it all into an Excel spreadsheet. In the future, we really, I think I've asked for this to have more detail in the past, and they didn't want to make the monthly revenue plan, a monthly revenue focus longer, so they aren't doing it, but maybe they could provide it to us when we ask, in a way that we can look at it. So, because this revenue is really important to their activities. But so if we take the agency estimates for these, in the first year, it's 124.7. And in the second year, it's 119.3. And we have nobody here from the highways. So I guess we're going to just have to take their estimates. So that is 100 and, I need to find, I looked at, we also have to have the costs of collection as they have revised them. And I know I looked at those just the other day, but now I can't find them again.
Representative Volmey?
Yes.
It's Chris. You don't need to concern yourself with the cost of collections at this time. You usually through column D. So you do the gross,
yeah,
and then the cost of collections is netted after the fact.
Yes.
The reason it's on the schedule before you is that if somebody were to go back to the official revenue plan for 20, 27.6, and that's because they deducted the 31.8 in cost of collections. Mm-hmm. Did your estimates, it was 259.4.
Oh, okay, good. Because they did change their cost of collections also. They lowered them. So, so all we have to do is vote on the, we don't have to vote on the net sum because it follows directly. So we'll vote to accept. I wish we could get the data that caused us to do this, but we will vote to accept their numbers for the motor vehicle fees as a group. For in FY20, 124.7 million, and in FY21, 119.3 million.
Representative Olmey,
mm-hmm,
could you also include the miscellaneous in the vote that you're going to take? Yes.
Oh, and the including the miscellaneous.
Okay, so that's going to stay at the 0.2 for each of
these. So this will be 124.9, or we'll just say the miscellaneous and the miscellaneous for 0.2 each year.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
So the clerk will call a roll for motor vehicle fines in 20 at 124.7, in 21 at 119.3, and miscellaneous each year at 0.2.
Tim Almy, Representative Burstein, stand up.
Oh, he does. Okay, Representative Burstein.
Yeah, thank you. I just got a text from Representative Edwards saying the power just went out at their house.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So Representative Edwards is absent at this point. I hope he gets his power back. So the clerk will call a roll for, I'm sorry, I've got a lawnmower outside my house now. I'm not sure I can be heard well, but before the lawnmower showed up, I did say what we were voting on.
Okay. To be clear, I'll put this all on one sheet. 124.7 motor vehicle fees for 20, 119.3 motor vehicle fees for 21, and 0.2 miscellaneous fees for 20, and 0.2 miscellaneous fees for 21.
Exactly.
Yes.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg. Yes. Oh, yeah, okay. Representative Tucker.
Representative, she seems to have disappeared.
Okay. Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo. Oh, I think she's gone too. Representative Griffith. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes, and I just also got the text from Jess. I think I'm done for the committee today. Eversource says the power won't come back until 4:15. So, I'm a yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette. Representative Doucette.
He's unmuted and he appears to be here, but no response.
Okay. Edwards is out. Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almy.
Yes, reluctantly.
This vote is interesting. It's 13 yays, no noes, and 6 not voting.
Right. Well, 13 is a quorum, unfortunately. Yeah. So, the vote being 13-0, motor vehicle fees for the department for highway fund for 20 of 124.7, for 21 of 119.3 plus miscellaneous fees of 0.2 for each year passes. And I just lost participants again. So we've got that there. And the only thing left to do is the fish and game page. All of us decided to agree with the agency. I would like to propose for the fish and game fund for FY20, Licenses at 10.2 million. All other for 4.2 million. And we don't have to do the total. And for 2021, for FY21, the licenses at 9.75 million, all other at 3.3 million, and the and we'll have to decide how to, whether we round up or down. 9.8 million and 3.3 million for all other. So is there anyone that wants to change those estimates? Round us down, whatever. Then I'm going to call.
Major has his hand up.
Representative Major.
So on FY21, mm-hmm. the licenses would be 9.8, and the all others would be 3.5.
All others. Oh, right, 3.5. Sorry.
All right, then I'm okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm reading from an old spreadsheet, and we'd taken them down slightly for reasons that weren't appropriate that I put in. So, call for a vote then on the Fish and Game Fund licenses in FY20. Of 10.2 and all other at 4.2. And then in FY21 licenses on at 9.8 and all other at 3.5. And the clerk will call the roll on those numbers.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg. Representative Schamburg. I didn't hear a comment.
He's muted.
Muted.
He was unmuted before.
Call him again.
Senator Schamburg.
Somebody has to unmute me.
Oh.
What say you?
Yea or nay?
Somebody has to unmute me.
You are unmuted. We can hear you.
What? Yes.
Okay.
We can hear you.
We can hear you.
Good.
Representative Tucker. Missing. Okay. Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo, I think, is absent. Representative Griffith is absent. Representative Lockman. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette. Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almey.
Yes.
Vote this time is 13 yes, 0 no, and 5 or so not voting.
Thank you. The vote being 13 to 0, the motion for fish and game revenues of FY20 licenses at 10.2 and other at 4.2, and in FY21 licenses at 9.8 and other 3.5 passes and is getting filled in. Okay, I think on, so I think we in the past, we have done a formal final vote on all of the revenues together. Have we not? Or
there's no reason you couldn't do it as one vote.
Yeah.
Can everybody see the fish and game and that I filled it in, and they can see the totals?
Yes.
And I can go back through the worksheets if people want to just see highway total again, and then the general education trust fund.
Okay. Why don't you do that? And then we'll just say as displayed in the worksheet.
So if everybody's all set with fish and game, I'll take you to highway.
Mm-hmm.
And your revisions resulted in a fiscal 20 amount of 239.9 and a fiscal 2021 of range of 234.5 to 240.5.
Mm-hmm.
If everybody's all set with that, I'll take you to the General Fund Education Trust Fund. So for fiscal year 20, your low total is 2427.3. Your high total is 2501.3 for 20. And for 21, it's 2261.0 to 2427.1. And again, that's fiscal 21.
Thank you. That's what I had also on. The clerk will call the roll on the spreadsheet as it exists right now with totals of 2427.3 to 2501.3 million in 20 and 2261.0 to 2427.1 in 21 for the general and education trust funds. And for the highway fund total.
It's on the screen.
And for the highway fund totals of 239.9 million in 20 and 240.5 million in a range of 234.5 to 240.5 million in 21. And the fish and game on totals being on 14.4 million in 20 and 13.3 million in 21. Representative Malloy.
Representative Ames.
Yes.
Representative Carrick.
Yes.
Representative Southworth.
Yes.
Clerk votes yes. Representative Schamburg.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Representative Bunker.
Yes.
Representative Gamarlo. Representative Griffith. Representative Stringham.
Yes.
Representative Major.
Yes.
Representative Griffin.
Yes.
Representative Ullery.
Yes.
Representative Abrami.
Yes.
Representative Lang. Representative Doucette. Representative Burstein.
Yes.
Representative Almy.
Yes.
Vote is 13 yes, 0 no's, and 5 not voting.
Thank you very much. The vote being 13 to 0 for the final spreadsheet of the four funds. I think we've completed our work. I wanted to really thank everybody, including those who have had to drop off towards the end, for a pretty long and exhausting day, and for the ability that all of us have shown to compromise with each other and to create yet another nonpartisan revenue estimate for the House. And particularly my colleagues, Dick Ames, Patrick Abrami, and Norm Major, in perhaps reverse order of importance. So perhaps. So I don't know if anybody else wants to make any other comments about this. We may still be meeting in executive session and other, I hope, other sessions after the 11th, dealing with Senate bills. It's going to depend on whether the Republican caucus decides to vote against the measure that changes our deadline so that we can complete this year. But I'm very glad that we have completed this work.
Representative Almy, you have Representative Major and Burstein with their hands up.
Representative Major?
Oh, thank you, Representative Almy. I want to second what Representative Almy has said. You know, to become good legislators, you have to know how to negotiate and compromise. This committee as a whole has shown that. And I certainly appreciate it. The work of Representative Almy, Representative Ames, Abrami, myself, and all the others. We know how to negotiate. We know how to compromise. And we have our differences. We can vote our differences, but we're still friends when it's all over. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. And Representative Burstein.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative Tucker began to get maudlin with you all, and since she's not here, I would gladly carry the torch for her to say how appreciative I am to serve on this committee. I appreciate the brain trust and leadership on both sides of the aisle. All four of you are terrific, and I think the clerk quietly gets it done, and thank you for that. And the staff is just wonderful. Chris, Jen, and everybody else, Karen. It's just a privilege to work with you all, and I'm fortunate to be able to. Thank you.
Thank you. And Representative Ullery?
Yeah, I'm sorry I interrupted earlier, but that was a serious email message that I got. It's apparently a credible threat to Manchester, and it may or may not spread to Concord and Nashua, more likely Nashua. But apparently they're talking about busloads of people, and there's a...
We can barely hear you.
I'm saying that there's a credible threat against Manchester and maybe Nashua, less likely Concord, tomorrow, unknown what time, probably the evening. Law enforcement is looking for truckloads of bricks being delivered to either one of the cities.
Bricks. Oh, great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, stay away from Manchester tomorrow.
Or if you're in Manchester, stay home.
Yeah. Well, stay away from Elm Street, that's for sure.
Yeah. Okay. Representative Abrami, you had your hand up.
Oh, I'm like, yes. This is coming to the floor on the 11th, correct? Is it coming to the floor on the 11th, June 11th?
Well, I think it depends on how you vote on extending the deadlines. I'm not sure.
All we need is Dick and the speaker to keep on talking.
Yep.
Yes.
Keep right. Negotiating and compromising.
Yes, that would be very good. So if it doesn't, I think we're going to try to put out some kind of press release or something if we get stopped from continuing, which it seems to me is not appropriate at this time because a lot of other bills in the legislature are nonpartisan also that are stuck by this. But anyway, I forgot, and I really shouldn't have forgotten to include in my thanks the clerk, Representative yes. Malloy. He carries a lot of the burden on these sessions, especially revenue estimates where we had to do all of these votes.
Thank you, Dennis.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
And thanks, Jenny, and all the other support staff.
And we have had a lot of contribution from both of our caucuses besides the people that I mentioned. So including Jerry Stringham, who on our side has been running the hosting a lot of the time. So that concludes today's sessions.
Just one quick yes? comment before you leave.
Yes.
So as mentioned earlier, I'll send out the spreadsheet as you saw in the view. I'll send it out as a PDF to each member as well as an Excel. I'll get it posted on the General Court website. So all your agency information, go to the General Court homepage. It says General Court. Mm-hmm. In that box, you'll see a link to all the agency's documents. So uh-huh. they'll be available. If for some reason you can't find them in your files, they will be available online. Also,
In which part of the General Court website? In the LBAO?
No, when you go to the General Court homepage,
mm-hmm.
there's a box that says General Court News. Inside that box, you're going to see a Ways and Means link, and that'll take you to the agency documents from the last, and we'll add in the information from today. The other piece that I just wanted to mention is that when we're concluded here, I'll put the information together in the format for your resolution. I'll submit it to OLS. They should have that turned around. I don't think they'll get it done today because I probably won't get it to them before 4:00, mm-hmm. 4:30. But they'll have something back for you tomorrow, Rep. So okay. You'll probably be reached out to by OLS. And that's all I had.
Okay. Good, thank you. And we can, once I get that, I can share it around to everyone too, the green sheet. It will be in a form that we haven't seen before due to the highs and lows.
I can give you, if you want, I can show a sneak peek, but I think everybody wants to get going.
Yes, I think everybody wants to get going too. And I just had a phone call from someone I hung up on in our last meeting because we were in meeting. So thank you all again very, very much. And I'm adjourning this meeting. Oh, and thank you also to the support staff. I forgot to say that.
Care, guys.
Thanks, Jim. See you, Susan.